Good morning, everybody.
Good morning.
How are you?
Good.
I promise I'm not going to preach for 90 minutes.
All right.
85 maybe, but never 90.
I got my watch going.
Okay, you do that. All right. Well, it's been an interesting weekend, really powerful. Thank the Lord for all of his goodness to us. I don't have a bunch of clever remarks to make. They say that the modern preaching protocols, you're supposed to get up and tell a joke or two. I don't have any jokes to tell, so I'm going to dispense with that part. I will just tell you this message I'm going to bring you is not, it's not a new message, but it was a really important message during the Australian revival when I was out there leading that about 10 years ago. And I really had not preached it for about 9.5 years. And I just kind of, you know, it's on the iPad, but I'd sort of forgotten about it. And a couple of weeks ago, I was at a church, and I felt prompted as I was praying about what to speak on. I thought I was going to write a new message, and I felt prompted to pull this one out. So I did it, and it went really well. And one of the leaders in the church said to me, "You should be preaching that message all over America." So I was like, huh, that's interesting. So I preached it last weekend in the central coast of California, and all I can say is the Holy Spirit annihilated the church. I mean, it was crazy. We didn't get out of there until, I don't know what it was, 3 o'clock or something in the afternoon. So I thought this would be a really good message to follow up the weekend with, since the weekend was called Hope and Glory. So that's the equivalent of my joke. I'm actually not joking. We're going to look this morning at 2 Kings chapter 6. And by the way, don't worry, we're not going to hold you up till 3 o'clock. You're free to go when you need to. We're going to look at 2 Kings chapter 6. And I want to talk about the secret of miracles. So 2 Kings 6, starting in verse 8. "Once when the king of Syria was warring against Israel, he took counsel with his servants, saying, 'At such and such a place shall be my camp.' But the man of God sent word to the king of Israel, 'Beware that you do not pass this place, for the Syrians are going down there.' And the king of Israel sent to the place about which the man of God told him. Thus he used to warn him, so that he saved himself there more than once or twice." Now, this is the way it reads, but that's confusing to some people. So before we even go further with the passage, let's just understand what we read. So the Syrians are raiding Israel, and they would come into the territory, and the man of God, the prophet, would send the word to the king and say, "Don't go to that area, because that's where the Syrian army is." And essentially he's saying, "You're not strong enough to face them, so stay away." And so the king of Israel would send someone to check it out, some spy, and he would look. And sure enough, there was the Syrian army. So they wouldn't bring the Israeli army there. They'd move them over here. And so the Syrians were looking for them, looking to destroy the army of Israel. And that would leave the whole country open. And so, and it says it didn't just happen once or twice, right? It was a kind of an ongoing thing. All right, so the mind of the king of Syria was greatly troubled because of this thing. And he called his servants and said to them, "Will you not show me who of us is for the king of Israel?" And one of the servants said, "None, my lord, O king, but Elisha, the prophet who is in Israel, tells the king of Israel the words that you speak in your bedroom." And he said, "Go and see where he is, that I may send and seize him." And it was told him, "Behold, he is in Dothan." So he sent their horses and chariots and a great army, and they came by night and surrounded the city. When the servant of the man of God rose early in the morning and went out, behold, an army with horses and chariots was all around the city. And the servant said, "Alas, my master, what shall we do?" He said, "Do not be afraid, for those who are with us are more than those who are with them." And then Elisha prayed and said, "O Lord, please open his eyes that he may see." So the Lord opened the eyes of the young man, and he saw, and behold, the mountain was full of horses and chariots of fire all around Elisha. And when the Syrians came down against him, Elisha prayed to the Lord and said, "Please strike this people with blindness." So he struck them with blindness in accordance with the prayer of Elisha. And Elisha said to them, "This is not the way, and this is not the city. Follow me, and I will bring you to the man whom you seek." And he led them to Samaria. As soon as they entered Samaria, Elisha said, "O Lord, open the eyes of these men that they may see." So the Lord opened their eyes, and they saw, and behold, they were in the midst of the city of Samaria. As soon as the king of Israel saw them, he said to Elisha, "My father, shall I strike them down? Shall I strike them down?" He answered, "You shall not strike them down. Would you strike down those whom you have taken captive with your sword and your bow? Set bread and water before them, that they may eat and drink and go to their master." So he prepared for them a great feast, and when they had eaten and drunk, he sent them away, and they went to their master, and the Syrians did not come again on raids into the land of Israel. Well, as I said, we're going to talk about the secret of miracles. And as we start this morning, I just want to ask a question. You don't need to raise your hand or anything, but I want to ask you a question. If you had been there in Dothan on that morning, would you have been more like Elisha or more like his servant? It's an important question because, you know, maybe we don't have our city surrounded with an army looking for us personally, but we face challenges in life. Those challenges can be, you know, very personal. They can be health challenges, job loss, marriage is in trouble, child is not doing well with the Lord, market drops, you lost half your net worth. I mean, there's a lot of things that can go on that can seem like the whole world is coming apart. And so, you know, in the scheme of things, our problems might be somehow less than having an entire army hunting for you. But they're still our problems, and we face them as we do. And so if you'd been there in Dothan, or as you face your own life problems, how would you face them? Would you be like Elisha, calm, that the ones that are with you are greater than the ones that are arrayed against you? Or would you simply see the horses and chariots that are come against you to take you captive or kill you? Well, last night when I was preaching, I talked about Lonnie Frisbee, and he was the prophet that really was sent to the Vineyard movement from the Calvary Chapel movement, and from there he had been sent from Catherine Kuhlman's ministry. And so Lonnie affected actually multiple movements of the Lord, including some others in other countries that Americans don't generally know about. But one night I was with Lonnie in the Santa Cruz Mountains of California. We'd gone up there, and he was leading a retreat, and I was tagging along, kind of his, I don't know, understudy, learning from him. And so we're sitting by the campfire, and he made a kind of a random comment, but it was actually meant to be a teachable moment. And he said, you know, he had a kind of a high, nasally little voice, "You know, I only spend about 2% of my life in the Spirit." And Lonnie was, I would say, a highly catalytic individual. Where he went, things happened, and he affected change. And he said, most Christians spend about 0.5% of their time in the Spirit. And I thought, wow, well, that fourfold, you know, from 0.5% to 2%, that's 4x, if you do the math. That's a big, I mean, it doesn't sound like much from 0.5 to 4 to 2%, but that's a big difference if that's what's really going on here. But then he said something really profound. He said, I'm looking to go to 10%. And of course, what he meant was it's harder to do than you think it might be, but it's an important, you know, jump to make. So again, I'm back to the question, would you have been in the 0.5% or the 2%? Would you have been able to see the chariots and horses of fire that were with you as you're facing literal chariots and horses, maybe with flaming arrows? Well, as we think about that, I think most of us would probably say, yeah, I would be in that 0.5%. I would not have seen the chariots and horses of fire. I would have only been focused on what was in front of me in the natural. And yet the scriptures tell us over and over again about a spiritual reality which many of us do not frequently perceive. Now, this is an important word, and I'm deliberately using that exact verbiage, perceive. Because in biblical thought, there is seeing and there is perceiving. There's also hearing and perceiving. And so what you see or what you hear is what you pick up with your natural senses. But what you perceive is the spiritual reality behind what you see, We see an example of this, not to use the word see too many times. We have an example of this with the story of Moses in the burning bush. He's, you know, trucking through the desert with the sheep, and it says he looks over and he sees a burning bush. Now, we tend to blow that story up a bit, that maybe a little bit more than it should be. It should be blown up. It's an important story. It wouldn't be in the Bible if it weren't. But here's the thing. I've spent a lot of time in the desert because I live in Southern California, and most of the eastern part of our state is all desert. And I've done a lot of hunting in my time, especially for quail, which I love to hunt. I used to raise bird dogs, and you know, I'd take the dogs out and we'd go hunt quail. And I've seen burning bushes in the desert. They're not very common. I've only seen a couple. But the thing is, when the temperature gets hot enough and it's a creosote bush, that creosote will combust spontaneously just from the resin in it. Or sometimes you get what's called a dry lightning strike. There's no rain, but the lightning comes anyway because of the differential in the heat and the clouds and all the atmospheric stuff. And so it comes down, and a bush can get lit on fire. Well, Moses had spent 40 years in the wilderness tending sheep in a desert. So I suppose somewhere in 40 years he'd seen a burning bush or two anyway. But the point is, in Moses' story, he looks over and he sees this burning bush. And initially, that's all he sees is the bush. But then he says, I will turn aside and see this great sight. And so as he's you know, trucking through the desert with the sheep, he turns aside and goes toward it. And as he gets near the bush, it says, then he perceived the angel of the Lord. He didn't initially see the angel of the Lord. Perception follows seeing. That was free. So there's a world to be perceived, which we often do not perceive because we are focused on our natural senses. 2 Corinthians 4:18 says, the invisible world is superior to the natural and invisible world. This is what it says. And I'm quoting, so we fix our eyes not on what is seen, but on what is unseen. This is not only a statement, it's a directive. You are to fix your eyes not on what you see, but on what is the unseen. That means you must be operating in perception, not just seeing. Or if it's auditory, not just what you literally hear, but what is behind what you hear. For what is seen is temporary, but what is unseen is eternal. That word for could also be translated in the way we use English. It could also be translated because. Because the seen world is temporary, but the unseen is eternal. This world is passing away. Probably not passing away today, but the point is it's transient, it's transitory. And the scripture is very clear. It will burn up with fire. There will be nothing left of this world. But the unseen realities are unchanging. And part of our problem as Christians is that we are too worldly. We are too focused on what is seen, what is material, what will burn up with fire. And God is calling us to adjust our vision so that we are living in the realm of perception, not just seeing, in the realm of perception, not just hearing, so that we actually are grasping that. So we fix, we lock our eyes onto, not on what is seen, but on what is unseen. Now, if we're going to lock our eyes onto what is unseen, by definition, we are seeing beyond seeing. We can't be using these eyeballs to do that, unless the Lord uses them as a gateway and it opens up into the unseen realm. But it implies that there are different ways to see the unseen realm. That's a whole nother conversation, but I'm just throw that in for fun. So we fix our eyes not on what is seen, but on what is unseen, because what is seen is temporary and what is unseen is eternal. So back to what I was saying, the invisible world is superior to the natural visible world because it is eternal. But the natural world, as I already said, is temporary and passing away. Now this does not make us Gnostics. Gnosticism is making a resurgence in our time. And it's undergirding a lot of the popular stuff that's floating around in the body of Christ. And everywhere I run into it, I just try and cut it to the ground. We are not Gnostics because we do not believe, nor do we teach, that the natural world is illusory, nor do we teach that it doesn't matter. On the contrary, what we do in this world, it actually impacts what's going to happen to us in the unseen world in a later time. Gnostics don't believe that. And we also don't believe that the world around us is illusory. It's quite real. It's quite real. So faith, the faith that we're called to have, is actually anchored in the realm of the unseen because of this very truth that I'm highlighting for you, that the unseen world, the invisible world, is superior to the visible world. That's where faith rests. It's also one of the reasons why so many Christians struggle with faith, because they're constantly looking on this realm instead of to that one. They're not fixing their eyes on the right place. It's a little bit like a ship at sea. If you're at sea and the ship's going up and down and you're watching that, you're going to get seasick. If you fix your eyes on the horizon, usually you don't get seasick, because the horizon doesn't move. It's always out there and it doesn't go up and down. And so as you focus on that, no matter what's happening with you here, there's a steadiness, there's a constancy in it. Well, faith itself, according to the book of Hebrews, faith itself is evidence. It's evidence of what we hope for, and it is proof left behind from some prior existence, some prior reality of what we believe in. Hebrews 11, 1 and 2 says, faith is the substance. Faith is substance. Faith is not wishful thinking. Sometimes people say, I wish I had faith like you, but I just can't get there. Faith is confidence because it has substance that it is anchored into. It's the substance of things that we hope for that might be well in the future. Hope is generally a future-oriented word, but it is the evidence of things not seen. It is the proof that the unseen is actually real. And faith apprehends that. It perceives it and lays hold of it in confidence that God will make good on what we can see that is unseen. And this is what the ancients were commended for. So all of these stories of the great men and women of the Bible, all the great exploits that they went through, and the writer to the Hebrews goes on in chapter 11, I'm quoting from the first two verses, the writer to the Hebrews goes on later in chapter 11. And he says, you know, they shut the mouths of lions and they quenched the flames and they defeated foreign armies. And probably referring to this exact story when it talks about defeating foreign armies, at least one of the many cases where that happened. But it's because they were basing it on substance in the unseen world, which means they had trained their eyes to see things that were not otherwise seeable. Said another way, Elisha was the 2% or 10% guy, and his servant was at the 0.5% guy. Maybe he was in training to upgrade, and maybe he didn't make the upgrade. I don't know, but anyway. So, when we understand that faith is anchored in the realm of the unseen, and we understand that the invisible is superior to the visible world, when we understand that faith is evidence, evidence of the things we hope for and proof left behind of what we are to believe in, and we understand that the ancients received a commendation, an attaboy, an attagirl from God for living in this way, when we understand that, we can see how Elisha pulled it off in this situation. God is actually calling us to walk in this way. That's why we have an admonition to walk by faith and not by sight. I mean, it's right there in the Bible. God's calling us to walk in the ancient paths. Jeremiah 6:16 says, when you come to a crossroads is where you got to make a decision. You're going to go right, you're going to go left. It's like a four-way stop sign. I'm showing it as an X, but you know, this, do I go right, do I go left, do I go straight ahead? Maybe we have one intersection near my house that we call the five-way intersection, because it actually, you have four other choices as you drive up to it. So the five-way intersection is famous in our little part of town. So you might have multiple choices in front of you, and the problem is, what are you going to do? What are you going to do with your errant child, with your straying spouse, with your job falling apart, with your health crisis? What are you going to do? Well, the one thing you better not do is look at what is seen. Now, you do have to take it you have to take it seriously. It's real. It is a crisis. Being surrounded by an army, that's a crisis. It's not illusory. And your health crisis, your marriage crisis, this is not illusory. It's real. But you've got to look beyond that into the realm of the unseen. That's part of the personal application of this message. But in Jeremiah 6:16, Jeremiah says, when you come to that crossroads, when you've got everything on the line, what you should do is pause and consider, check in all directions, just like you would at a four-way or five-way intersection, and consider the ancient paths. That's exactly what Jeremiah says. And consider the ancient paths means revert to the ancient paths. Follow the way of the ancients. And they were commended for living the way that I am articulating right now. They got an attaboy. They got an attagirl from the Father because they did this. If we don't do that, no attaboy. So that's what God's calling on us to do, to live in that way. Now faith, true faith, the kind of faith I'm talking about, it literally lives in the revealed will of God. Now here's the thing about the will of God. You cannot know it except by revelation. The Lord says he hides himself in darkness. He does not just willy-nilly give things out. But we saw last night when we were talking about Moses that he wanted to know more of the ways of God. He prayed that he would know the will of God, that he would please God and continue doing that. And I called it the divine corkscrew. So the revealed will of God can come through two means. The first one is this book, the written word of God. And that's why we need to defend it. That's why we have to be in it. That's why we need to read it. We need to memorize it. It needs to frame our thinking. Part of the problem with our modern age, and it is an endemic problem in America, is that we no longer think biblically as a nation. Mostly in times past, there were periods of less and more, but in general, in years gone, people in America did their thinking according to the Word of God, and that kept us, well, it's part of what made us prosper and flourish and become powerful. Because the fear of the Lord is the beginning of wisdom. And we no longer do that. We don't do it at the highest levels of government. We don't do it at the lowest levels of government. And we can watch our country coming apart at the seams right now on every front because of that one thing. We are ignoring revelation right here in this book. The first thing we did was take it out of the schools. And that way a younger generation didn't learn it. We figured, well, the churches will pick up the task. But actually the churches have abandoned the Word of God. I've already read to you more scripture than you're commonly going to hear in a typical Sunday sermon anywhere in America today. I mean, there are, of course, churches that do still preach it, but in general, churches in America do not preach the Word of God. Just like I said, the formula nowadays is you open with a joke or a story. The other formula is that you read only one or two verses, and then you kind of springboard off of that and say whatever you want to say. That's not how I was taught to handle the Word of God, but I've actually had pastors tell me you read too much Bible when you preach. Literally, I've had pastors tell me that. And so that itself is a diagnostic on the malaise of America. The second way that we get revelation is through what we commonly call rhema. Rhema is the word of the Lord coming to you. It might be something like a word of knowledge or a word of wisdom. It can be a prophetic word. An angel comes to you. You have a dream. Could be anything like that and way beyond all that. I'm just giving you some examples. But rhema is what we usually think of as kind of the spoken or the more transient word of the Lord. It's not written down. It's not scripture quality, but it is still revelatory. And these are the only two ways you can know the will of God. You can't divine the will of God. You know, the Greek prophets in the time of the New Testament, they would try to divine the will of God through augury, or which was usually to take an animal, kill it, and then the way the guts spilled out on the plate, that would tell them something about the future. That's literally what divining was. Or they might take a divining rod and they would use it to divine, to figure out where's the water, where's the oil, where's the gold, whatever we're looking for under the surface. So most of man's attempts at understanding God. I'm answering somebody's question right now, just so you know. This is in my notes, but there's somebody sitting in the room right now, and you've been asking, how do we know what truth is? I'm telling you your answer. You came to church this morning wanting to know this question, and I'm answering your question right now. So most of man's efforts involve us trying to figure out what does God want, and that's what most of religion is all about. whichever form of it you want to talk about. Hinduism, Sikhism, Jainism, Buddhism, Zoroastrianism, Taoism, anything. Islam. But revelation is when God says, I'm going to part the veil and I'm going to give truth. And the only way to know it is because God gives it. Whether in this book, which one time came as, I guess, a rhema, but it was deemed high enough quality rhema. It got written down and scripturated and held for all posterity. Or because in the now, we have our own version of rhema. Elisha's vision would be a form of that. He saw what was there that his servant didn't see. So true faith lives in the revealed will of God. It rests in the confidence that the Lord does not change and cannot lie, and consequently will fulfill what he has spoken. But it is a confidence. This is what faith really is about. It's not kind of, you know, trying hard to believe. Faith is confidence. Oh, Lord, you said it. You're good for your word. What you said is going to happen. That's the way it's supposed to be. So if God's will hasn't been revealed, we can't grasp it. I think I made that point already. And that's why, of necessity, we must have revelation. And similarly, if we misperceive the will of God, if we get that wrong, then our faith, which delves into that word, grabs hold of that evidence, then our faith, and with it our ability to overcome, to soar, to break through, to have an experience like in Elisha, that will be hindered. And so a lot of us are coming short of what God would have us to live in because of that shortfall. Here's an example. This has been a weekend of hope and glory and focused primarily on healing as opposed to deliverance last year. So, for example, if we think that God wants us to suffer because he wants to punish us, or maybe he just wants to build character, or maybe we think he's a sadist, some people think that, we won't have confidence to pray for healing because we'll think we're actually fighting God, we're contrary to his will. And so we tend to pray mealy-mouthed prayers, oh Lord, if it be your will, we ask, amen. We don't even have the courage to get the words out of our mouth. And so, you know, if you think about that line of reasoning just on that issue of healing, if people treated their children the way God is typically accused of treating his people, they would be arrested for child abuse. And so part of what we have to do is reframe our thinking about who God is. You remember what I was talking about during the conference. I said, part of Jesus' message is you need to change the way you think because the kingdom is breaking in. I mean, we had a conference this weekend. I don't know if you caught this. 6 people got born again on the overflow of that. They didn't get saved in the conference. It's what people caught at the conference and took away into their, wherever they were, hotel, and boom. I mean, that's an incredible thing. And it's a sign of what our Father really would like to have going on. I mean, that shouldn't be an exception. That should be, why only 6? Why not 10 or 12 or 60? Right? So God is actually a very good God, and we understand that by revelation. We would not know it if there were not revelation. Instead, what we would be doing as the world does, is we would be looking at the fallenness of the world, be looking at the war in Ukraine, we'd be looking at the machinations of politicians in London and Bonn, and, well, let's not forget Washington, and we would say, it's hopeless, they're all, you know, wicked scoundrels, and they are, mostly. There are some that are godly people, but, I mean, I think there's more scoundreling going on right now than less. But, you know, we would despair. But if we understand that God has a plan, then we look for that plan and we lean into that. That's faith in action. That pulls us out of the despair and the malaise of everything that hits us through our newsfeed, however we get it. So faith develops when we truly see, or to use a word I've already used, when we perceive the heart of God, when we perceive who God is. This is where faith arises. Because we have confidence in his goodness. He will not let me down. We sing songs like that. But do we really think about what we're saying when we sing? Now, unbelief, contrary to faith, unbelief is anchored in what is visible and reasonable apart from God. It literally functions as though there is no God. Unbelief makes you an atheist, or at least practically speaking, it makes you one. There's a lot of Christians who profess faith in God, but for all practical purposes, they are atheists. They are unbelieving believers, is what Bill Johnson calls them. And so unbelief sees the natural world completely opposite to what God wants. It sees the natural world as superior to the invisible world. And it walks not by faith, but by sight. And so only what can be seen, only what can be heard, only what can be measured is reckoned to be real and trustworthy. It sees the natural world as superior to the unseen. The unbelief is faith in the inferior, and with this, unbelief is rooted in materialism. Now, when I say materialism, I do not mean the accumulation of goods, at least not primarily. There are materialists, and that is what they do. They buy, you know, lots of cars and lots of whatever toys that they want to have, spare homes aplenty, they have enough money to do it, boats, and on it goes, right? Vacation homes and jet skis and snow machines and, you know, blah, 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 just kind of multiplying it. So materialism in this instance, I'm not really talking about that accumulation of goods, but that accumulation of goods is sometimes an indication that people are living in an inferior reality because they don't understand that the way to lay up treasure for yourself is not here on the earth where moth and rust can destroy it, but rather to lay it up in heaven. And, of course, you can't see it up in heaven unless you're perceiving rather than seeing. Does this make sense? So materialism is faith in the natural as the superior reality. That's really at the core of materialism. And again, I don't principally mean the acquisition of goods. I just mean living as a materialist. Think of Madonna's song, living as a material girl, living in a material world, right? In a sensual society, and trust me, we live in one of those, we are trained to believe only in what we can measure through the five senses because a sensual society serves the senses for the purpose of pleasure. Pleasure becomes the highest good. Now, and by the way, in biblical thought, this is not a virtuous way to live, to serve your senses for pleasure. This is why Jesus says you must take up your cross, deny yourself, and follow me. This is why fasting is a Christian discipline. We are denying ourselves the pleasure of food and drink. All right, these are all, I heard that. These are all reasons why we do these things in order that we would not destroy, but we would put in its proper place the pleasures of the flesh. God gave us eyes to enjoy beauty. He gave us ears to enjoy music and, you know, people's voices and the chirping of birds and all that. There's nothing wrong with this. But sometimes a silence retreat is a good thing because we deprive that pleasure channel. And, you know, similarly, Paul talks even in 1 Corinthians about there will be times when married couples deny each other the pleasure of the marriage bed in order that they may pray. And he says, don't let it go on too long. You get into trouble doing that one. But the point is, that's a thing too. So we'll put that one in the category of touch, right? You deny the pleasure of touch. And, you know, we can go down the list and talk about all five of the senses, but you get the idea. So in a sensual society, everything we do is oriented towards satisfying the sensual pleasures of life. I mean, I know pastors who say, I'm a foodie. And I think that is not a good thing to be. I mean, it's okay to enjoy good food. I enjoy good food, but I never, ever think of myself as a foodie, especially as a traveling guy, because sometimes I don't get that good of a meal. There's just no time for it. Well, that's just reality. But it's more than that. It's that I don't want food to become my God. You know, Paul uses this language. Their God is their belly. Watch out, right? There's a reason Nazarites, who generally were prophets, were denied the pleasures of the fruit of the vine. And they couldn't just not drink wine. They couldn't drink grape juice, lest it possibly be a little bit fermented. Well, okay, again, we're dealing with the sensual things in order that we would perceive the higher things. Does this make sense?
Yes.
So these Christian disciplines are actually rooted in something very profound. But we live in a sensual society right now, and in our time, everything that is pushed at us through all of the marketing and all of the channels of media Everything is designed to turn us into materialists, satisfying the five senses. And so in a sensual society, we tend to believe only in what we can measure or buy or reproduce on demand when we want it. Real faith doesn't deny the natural realm. People with tumors still have tumors. The tumors are real. We're not Christian scientists here denying that reality. People of faith are realists, but faith sees a reality greater than the tumor. Faith sees the equivalent of the chariots of fire when you've got an army facing you around your city. Here are some examples, though, to expand this idea, because in fact, every person in this room is already practicing this on some level, and I'm going to show you this in just a second. And what I'm trying to help you do is step out of where you're already doing this, because you'll understand that it's actually not that big of a leap. You'll step into it in order that you would come into the thing God would have you to live in. So Christy's dad and I, some years ago, I went to visit him in Utah when they were living in Utah, and we went fishing. And we were walking up to a lake that he liked, and so, you know, we're hiking up the mountain together, and there's a stream, and it wasn't a very big stream. I mean, it wasn't even as wide as these four chairs right here. It was just this little tiny creek coming down from the spillwater of that lake that we were headed toward. And as we're walking along the stream, Christy's dad says to me, "You see that trout right there?" And I said, "I don't see anything." He goes, "Look at that little riffle coming down over that rock. He's right below the riffle." I said, "I don't see anything." He takes off his backpack and he gets out a pair of polarized sunglasses. He goes, "Try these." I put them on. "Oh, yeah, there's a trout there." He goes, "Shh, you're going to scare him." "What do I do?" He goes, "Take your fishing line and just kind of plunk that line right there." He said, "That fish will take that piece of bait because he's waiting for food to come down the stream. And he'll think that this is food coming down the stream." Plunk. Reeled it just, you know, half a reel just to get it in position. Fish took the line. I didn't even see that fish, but it was always there. It took polarized lenses to see it. And Christy's dad, who was a better fisherman than I was and was trained to do this, and you know he loved to fish, he could see it immediately because he was accustomed to living in that world. I had a similar experience one time. I went to Africa to go hunting, and I'd done a lot of hunting here in the U.S., and sooner or later people who do a lot of hunting, I hope I don't offend you. I know this is an urban setting. It was safe in South Carolina. I don't know. Anyway, here we go. So I went to Africa to go hunting, right? And there's a lot of animals in Africa. You look around, you're like, "Wow, look at all these animals. They're everywhere." But you don't have any idea how many animals there are. So, you know, one day we're driving along, and the professional hunter, the guide, you know, we're driving along. He just slams on the brakes, and he goes, "Kill that sable!" And he's down there. I didn't see it at all. He takes my head. "Get your rifle. Shoot that sable. He's going to jump." I'm like, "I don't see him at all." He goes, "Down there. Look. Oh, yeah." All right. The sable was there all along. But I wasn't focusing on that because I was used to looking at things that move. I'm looking at the dashboard of the Jeep. I'm, you know, drinking a bottle of water. I'm completely distracted about the unseen realm that's around me. I was in the 0.5, not the 2 or the 10%. Are you with me? Here's another example. Every single person in this room has one of these somewhere on them, and it should be in flight mode like mine is. When you use one of these, you are relying on an unseen reality. You can't see those waves, electromagnetic spectrum. You can have a phone call on it. You use your navigator to help you get to places you don't even know where it is. You send and receive texts. You place orders for food. You buy things online. You're completely relying on an unseen reality. You just have come to the place where you trust it. That's how it works. So there's an example of how we do it. Here's a third one, and then we'll keep going. Bernoulli's theorem. I know you all woke up thinking about Bernoulli's theorem. But Bernoulli's theorem is a scientific principle that when gas, think of air, is moved fast enough, it will become like a liquid. It becomes no longer compressible. It's called non-compressible. And when it becomes non-compressible, its properties change. So where do we use Bernoulli's theorem? Every time we get on an airplane. This is what causes an airplane to take off. When the airplane accelerates down the runway, because of the thrust of the engines, it reaches a certain speed. At that speed, the air flowing over the wing becomes non-compressible, and because of that, you get a hydrofoil type effect, and it literally lifts the plane into the air, overcoming gravity. Which is the greater reality? Bernoulli's theorem or gravity? Well, it depends on how fast you're going, right? If the airplane's flying and you hit stall speed, Bernoulli's theorem stops working and gravity takes over, so the airplane falls. But you literally put your life in the hands of Bernoulli's theorem every single time you get on an airplane. You may not realize it. But here's a fun trick to try sometime. This works best on days when it's a little bit cool and there's some humidity in the air. Doesn't need to be freezing cold, but a little bit cool and some humidity in the air. Get a window seat on such a day. And as you're sitting there on the leading edge of the plane, you got to be in that seat where you can really see the front edge of the plane. What you'll see is more when it lands than when it takes off, but if you're watching, you'll see it when it takes off too. You'll literally see something about this wide and white come right over the leading edge of the wing and flow off the back edge of the wing. You are literally seeing the unseen realm. You are watching Bernoulli's theorem in practice because you are watching the compressibility of air stop. It becomes a liquid, and that's your airplane taking off right there or landing. That's it. I mean, it's a reality, and you can see it. Now, I've given you multiple examples from kind of everyday life. Well, it depends if you hunt or fish. But I've given you examples from everyday life that you can relate to. You are already doing this, but you may not be doing it with spiritual matters. So those who are filled with unbelief, those who are the materialists, they often call themselves the realists. And if they're right that they're the realists, then God is calling us to be super realists. Or if you want to change the language a little bit, we might say we are the realists and those who live in the material world are sub-realists. But the point is there's a two-tier system here. And I don't care what you call those tiers, as long as you understand that the superior is better than the invisible is superior to the visible. That's the main point, regardless of the label you put on it. Well, this, of course, leads us to a very important question. And the question is, how do we become super-realists? Or how do we become true realists, if you like that way of saying it better? Well, the Bible gives us an answer to this too. It's found in Colossians 3, verses 1 and 2. And in Colossians 3, 1 and 2, Paul says this, since then you have been raised in Christ. So what's the first supposition? This only works for Christians. It's kind of like when I was talking about the power of God last night. It's only for Christians. This will only work if you're a believer. So if you're not a believer, and you're sitting in the crowd today listening to this sermon and you like what you're hearing and you'd like to step into this reality, before you do that, step up to the front at the end and we'll lead you to faith, and then this becomes an available thing for you. But it will not work for a non-believer. It's part of the reason why they oppose the way we live, because they literally can't see it. Okay, here we go. Since then, you have been raised with Christ. That's the assumption set. Here's what you are to do. Set your hearts on things above where Christ is. Now, what is the heart? Well, it's here, but if we think about it from a biblical perspective, it's more than just a physical organ that beats. The heart is the seat of emotions, and even more than that, it is the seat of your affections. The things that fascinate you, the things that captivate you, the things that you long for, the things that you desire. David says, my heart yearns for the courts of the Lord. There are many other verses like that, but that's just one. So Paul says, set your hearts on things above, that's the unseen world, where Christ is seated at the right hand of God. And then he follows it up with another instruction, set your minds on things above, not on earthly things. So it's not just what's in your affections, it's what are you thinking about all the time. For a lot of men, it's sports. Or sex. For women, it may be concerns about the children or whether their husband is thinking about sex. But the point is, what are you thinking about? What consumes your thought life? And Paul says this, set your hearts and minds. That's an instruction that is directing your will. Now, there are three parts to the human soul: the will, the emotions, and the mind. And what Paul is saying, this is important, you have to, as a choice of your will, direct your affections heavenward, where Christ is seated at the right hand of God. So if you need to, visualize that. There he is. I see him on the right hand of God. If he's on the right hand, that means as I look at him, he's on the left side of the two of them sitting side by side. I hope you followed that. If they're up here facing you, the right hand is over here. But from down here, the right looks to be the left. So I see Jesus on the left side of the Father from down here, even though he's on the right side of the Father up there. Okay, let's keep going. Choose as an act of your will to set your affections on that and make your thoughts dwell on heavenly things rather than the things of the earth that consume you. Now, yes, you have a job, you have children to care for, you've got bills to pay. Some of your bandwidth has to be taken up with just managing life, because we do live in an earthly world. We do have to function in this age. But it's that other part of what you're doing. That's what takes you from 0.5 to 2 to 10%. And this is something that if you're following what I'm saying, we've covered the three parts of the soul. When this happens, we are actually living into convergence. Or there are other words we could use for the same idea, but this morning I'm using convergence. So as all of these three things converge, we could also call it living in unity. The scripture says it was the intention of the Father to unite all things in Christ. This only happens through Christ. When this happens, there is a unification, there is a solidification of our soul. Most of us live with a splintered, fractured soul. And here's what the scripture says about a splintered, fractured soul. It says, a double-minded man is unstable in all his ways. That's also true of women. And that man should not think that he will receive anything that he asks from the Father. Why? Because of that dividedness, because of that splinteredness. But when we pull together mind, will, and emotions, our splintered souls come together, and now that very human part of us is fully aligned with God, and as we do that, we somehow connect to that power that God intends for us to walk in. And out of that comes a release of miracles. Smith Wigglesworth was a famous healer. He lived in the early 20th century. He's credited with raising a number of people from the dead, all kinds of healing miracles. And Smith Wigglesworth once said, I am not moved by what I see, but by what I believe. This is the exact principle I'm talking about. I don't make my choices and decisions based on what my eyes tell me. I make my choices and decisions by what I believe, means I'm seeing the unseen realm. I know what the unseen realities are. I know what the will of the Father is. I know what the true spiritual calculus of this situation is. And rather than focusing here, I'm focusing here. And by doing that, this is what causes me to live in the realm of miracles. I mean, he literally gave the secret up, but he didn't unpack it the way I'm unpacking it. And so, if I'm not moved by what I see, but by what I believe, Wigglesworth went on and he said, if I walk into a room and the Spirit of God is not moving, I move the Spirit. Now that sounds rather arrogant, except if you understand that we're living into convergence into the will of God, because our will, emotions, and mind are all focused on this. Well, with that, just like Jesus, we're saying, I'm only going to do what the Father shows me to do, and that drives my will, and with that, I can actually release through me the thing that God intended to do. Does that make sense? You know where you see an example of this? Moses is being tracked by the Egyptian army, and he cries out to God, and the Lord says, why are you crying out to me? Do something about it.
Yes, sir.
He doesn't say that line, but that's what's going on. And Moses is like, well, what am I supposed to do? You see that rod in your hand? Stretch it out over the sea. As an act of will, stretch it out over the sea. You will converge with my will. That will split the waters and the sea parts and the people of Israel go through. You can see it in operation in the lives of the ancients. And for this, they were commended. So, what can stop all of this from happening? All that stuff that fractures the soul. All those mixed up emotions, anger, unforgiveness, bitterness, lust, greed. We can just go on down the list with more. All that stuff that distracts us. It may not in itself even be bad. It might be okay. I don't think there's anything wrong with watching sports. When it becomes your magnificent obsession instead of him being your magnificent obsession, that's a problem. But you can watch sports. I'm not opposed to that. I just told you I like to hunt and fish. I mean, I don't do a ton of it these days. I'm too busy, but it doesn't mean I don't like to do it, but I keep it in balance. I mean, this is where my focus really is. So here's the thing, and we're almost done here. Fear of appearing to live in denial or unreality, what the world would call unreality, keeps many people from living the life of faith, and as a result, they settle for unbelief. In the Bible, fear of man or fear of woman is strongly associated with unbelief. These two are actually very closely linked. Whereas the fear of God is always associated with faith. If you have a proper and healthy fear of God, and you live in that convergence that I was describing, you will automatically start living the life of faith. You will perceive unseen reality, and things will begin happening around you. God is calling us to live a life of faith where the unseen becomes to us more real than the seen. And when we reach this place, we will break through into the realm of miracles. And they will become a regular matter, of course. That's it. That's the secret of miracles. Now, let me just say this in closing. Here's my closing story. I'm doing that part right in the modern sermon technique. This is a simple concept. Converge your will, emotions, and your mind. That's a simple concept. But the idea is much easier than the execution. The idea is much easier than the execution. Some years ago, I had a friend, and he was on the amateur pro tour playing golf. He'd gone to Auburn University. He eventually did go pro. He played at, you know, Augusta and other amazing places. And so he's my roommate, and I had to learn how to play golf when I worked for John Wimber in the Vineyard, because all the pastors played golf, and that you just, you know, if you're going to be in the club, you got to show up. So, I mean, I didn't know how to play golf. I didn't have a dad to teach me how to play golf. My dad died when I was 4. My mother was not a golfer, and anyway, golf was for the rich. We didn't have any money, so why would I ever play golf? But anyway, I had this roommate named Dave, and he liked to play golf a lot, and he was really good at it. So we would go down to the range, and we would hit buckets of balls, and, you know, he kind of watched me a little bit, and he's like, can I give you some pointers? And I'm like, yeah, please. So I'm going to tell you what Dave taught me. Uh-oh. Somebody's phone's not in flight mode. All right, so here's how you do it. When you tee up your ball, you put it down and you set your tee at about mid-height. Not low, not high. And you line it up with your left toe if you're a right-handed golfer, which is what I am. Now, I know some of you think you're supposed to straddle the ball. I don't know. All I can tell you is this is Dave's method. And Dave could hit a ball straight, no slice. Depending on the club he picked up, everything was always the same. If he was using a pitching wedge, maybe he'd hit it, you know, 50 yards, or if he hit it a little softer, maybe 30. But if he got out of one wood, he could hit it 450 yards, straight down the fairway, no slice, never into the trees. Had afterburners, but that was about it. Golf ball's on fire, right? So you line up your left toe with the ball. And again, I know some of you think this is the way. I'm telling you Dave's way. Have you ever been on the amateur pro tour? All right. When you pick the club up, you put it in your hand like this, and you put your thumb down on the flat part of the top of the club, and you wrap these fingers like that. That's not really controversial. No one's really going to challenge that one. Then you take this pinky finger and this index finger, and you interlock them like this. You put that one down, you put that one down, you grab the club like that. That's not too controversial. Most people will agree with that. When you go to swing, you draw back, and you use your wrists like this. And you keep your left arm locked. You cannot bend your left elbow. You do not bend your left elbow. I know for some of you, you've been taught it's okay, maybe like a baseball bat. This is Dave's method. I'm just telling you what Dave said. Okay, so here we are. And we lock in, and we keep our head down, eyes on the ball. We don't look back when we do this. We keep our eye on the ball. Some of you don't do that. I'm telling you Dave's method, not mine. All right, so here we are. And we go to make the swing. So we draw back, and we keep our eye on the ball. We keep that left arm straight. We come all the way back, and all the power is coming as we come through with our hips and we drive keeping our eye on the ball, and the only thing that changes is which club you've got, and that determines how far the ball goes. It's always the same thing that you're doing. Now, I understand the concept, but when I go to hit a golf ball, it looks more like this. Have I mastered the technique? No. I'm not Dave, but I know Dave's technique. And every now and then I get an inspirational burst and I'll go down to the driving range and I'll put in, get a bucket of balls and I'll start doing this. And as I work it a little bit, instead of doing what I just showed you, it starts to look more like Dave. And Dave was a machine. Off these balls go, and never deviating. And well, I'm still not as good as Dave, but if I focus on it, I can get there. Well, it's one thing to know the theory of how to hit a golf ball. It's another thing to do it all the time. It's one thing to know the secret of miracles. It's another thing to walk in that reality all the time. Now that I've told you what to do, go thou and do likewise, and find your way to the 10% so you can exceed Lonnie Frisbee.